Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Dear viewers, welcome back again to your Islamic program. MashaAllah, Islam and Life, Alhamdulillah. Before the breaks, we are just covering some of the questions sent to us already by the many of the brothers and sisters, Alhamdulillah. Next question, my viewers, we have is that, MashaAllah, a sister has asked a very nice question, MashaAllah, that I can't stop my husband smoking. Please, can you give me some advice regarding this? That a sister has asked that my husband, he keeps on smoking, and I try to advise him not to smoke, and but he does not quit, he does not give up. Can you please give some advice regarding it, mashallah? Jazakallah, sisters. Mashallah, whoever has asked this question, may Allah Azza wa Jalla grant you immense rewards for your question, alhamdulillah. My brothers and my sisters, as far as smoking is concerned, smoking is really bad for your health. Smoking makes you waste money, and smoking is bad for the environment as well. Smoking is bad for the children as well. As far as smoking in the house is concerned, it can give many of the harms to the children as well. And people who normally don't smoke, if they smell the smoke from other people, they are likely to be more affected from the smoke. Therefore, as far as smoking is concerned, a person should avoid it. It's harming to the health, and it's wasting of the money as well, and it really affects the other people as well. This is why we see in England that many of the public places, since few years, the government has made the law that we are not allowed to smoke in there because of the considering the health of the public and the people. Therefore, as far as smoking is concerned, smoking really affects the health of the people, and it really affects the people who are vulnerable, who are children in young age. Therefore, we should avoid. And as a husband and wife is concerned, if husband and wife, they advise each other for the virtues, for the good stuff, we should always take it into consideration. We should not be thinking that, oh, why should the wife advise me, or the wife should not think that, why should the husband advise me. If it is necessary and if it is anything good, we should always take it from one another, because Allah Azza wa Jalla has said in the Holy Quran, ta'awanu ala al-birri wa taqwa wa la ta'awanu ala al-ithmi wa al-udwan, that help and support one another for the virtuous things, and wa la ta'awanu ala al-ithmi wa al-udwan, and do not support one another for something which is sinful and something which is which will take people over the limit. Therefore, we should not be supporting one another for the evils. However, we should be supporting and advising one another for the good cause. May Allah Azza wa Jalla give us the tawfiq to understand. Another person has asked, what is the ruling for gambling? That many people, they do gambling, then what is the ruling of it? MashaAllah, very nice question again. As far as gambling is concerned, it's haram, and Allah Azza wa Jalla has made it haram clearly in the verses of the Holy Quran. Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ. Verily, alcohol and the wine, وَالْمَيْسِرُ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, وَالْمَيْسِرُ, the gambling. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنْصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls them filthy. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, min amal ash-shaytan, from the action of the deviant shaytan, min amal ash-shaytan. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, fajtanibuhu, refrain from them, la'allakum tuflihun, so that you may be successful. So as far as gambling is concerned, it takes the money away from a person. It makes a person waste his earned money. It allows a person to destroy his capacity, the savings. It makes a person kind of like convicted and kind of like dreaming about earning the money in the haram way. Therefore, Sharia has made it haram. My brothers and my sisters, all those things Sharia has made haram for us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made them, or His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has made them haram for us with the information from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is the due to reason, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our creator. So as a creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows that what is going to be benefiting us and what is going to harm us. Therefore, those things which are beneficial for us, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made them legal for us, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them halal for us. And those things which are going to harm us, either physically on our body, or financially on our wealth, or socially, or morally, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made them haram for us. Therefore, gambling, it financially it destroys our money. Financially, it makes us lose our money. Financially, it has an effect on a person, that this person, once upon a time, he was an established person in the society. Because of getting involved in al-maisir, which is known as gambling, now this person has lost everything. He has lost the wealth. He has lost the respect and the status in the society. Therefore, Allah subhanahu subhanahu wa ta'ala has made the gambling haram, so we can refrain from it and we can live a better life without gambling. May Allah Azza wa Jalla grant us the ability to understand. Another brother has asked a very nice question as well, and it's relevant in the time, current time, that should I attend those parties where alcohol is served? MashaAllah, very nice question, that as a Muslim, should I attend those parties where alcohol is served? MashaAllah, my brothers and my sisters, as a believer, as a Muslim, before we say anything, before we do anything, we have to make sure two things. Number one, because of me saying it or because of me doing it, will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be happy with it? And will I get any benefit? So if it is the case that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be happy with it and I will get benefit, then it is allowed for me and all the believers to say it and to do it. And number two, that the thing which is I am going to say or do, is that according to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? If it is according to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, proceed with it, do it. And if it is not according to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then hold on to it, don't do it, don't proceed, because our entire life is given to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and we have to spend it in the way explained and commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, in the hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, if a person believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and in the last day, the day of judgment, when he has to, an entire humanity has to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if this person has that fear, then he should not attend those tables where the alcohol is served. So therefore, if those parties where the alcohol is served, and especially in this season when there will be a lot of parties and then a lot of dancing going around and people will be attending those parties, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that attending those parties where the alcohol will be served, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, whoever believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the last day, he should refrain attending those parties. So therefore, in this party season, when many people will be giving parties out and then people will be joining with many of the haram things going on in the parties, may Allah Azza wa Jalla grant us the ability to refrain from these. My brothers and my sisters, always remember that whenever joining any of the da'wah, any of the parties, etc., etc., always remember that if where the party is held, is there any benefit in going in there or is there any harm? If the harm is there and there is no benefit, just to refrain from the harm, don't attend those parties, because it's better to refrain from the harms than getting any benefit. May Allah Azza wa Jalla grant us the ability to understand. Another person has asked another question as well, that if my neighbors are not very good, what should I do? Subhanallah, that if the neighbors are not very good, then what should I do? As far as neighbors are concerned, they should always be caring regarding their neighbors. They should be nice and polite towards their neighbors. Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the hadith that Sayyiduna Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam kept advising me regarding the rights of the neighbors, that I thought Jibreel alayhi salatu wa sallam, with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will make the neighbors from the inheritors. That after a person's death, inheritors, the people who are close related to him, they are the ones take the inheritance from these person's wealth. So I thought that Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam emphasized so much regarding the rights of the neighbors, that I started to think that Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam, with the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he will make the neighbors from the inheritors, that after my death they will have the inheritance. Allahu Akbar. So in this hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasalam is trying to say how much is the rights of the neighbors are and what is the importance regarding maintaining the rights of the neighbors. So as far as neighbors are concerned, they should be nice and polite towards the other people. They should not be disturbing. They should not be doing anything which harms the people surrounding them. Therefore, if the neighbors are not really friendly, then pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants them the understanding and they be also nice to you. Similarly, that you never be rude to them or bad to them. If they are kind of bad to you, then always pay a good return, that always be nice and kind to them. Inshallah, one day they will realize and they will understand, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will soften their heart hearts, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give them the understanding of realizing their mistakes. What many a time it seems to happen is that many a times people block the driveways, and people play loud music, and people when they have any kind of gatherings, it seems to like they scream and shout, and especially when the children are at sleep and the elderly people are at sleep, and then the people who are ill, they are having a rest, and then at that time it becomes a really bad scenario, that because of the neighbors, other people are getting disturbed. At that time, always be patient and always be polite, never retaliate in a bad manner, always be nice and kind, and make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants them the understanding. Inshallah, by that, gradually, inshallah, things will change. Another person has asked a very nice question again, that why was Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu appointed as the first successor of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, i.e. why Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was appointed as the first khalif of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Again, very nice question. My brothers and my sisters, as far as Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu is concerned, amongst the Sahaba, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he had the highest position. In one hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, all those people from my companions, whoever has done any favors on me, I have paid it back to them. Except for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, all the favors and all the supports Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu has done to me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant him rewards in the hereafter. Allah ta'ala will give him the returns in the hereafter. Therefore, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu has done so much to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, so much to support Islam, that no other Sahaba has done so much as equal as Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Therefore, in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given many of the clear evidences, clear hadith. In there, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicated that after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it will be Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu who will become Khalif. For example, in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu led 17 numbers of salah in the presence of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ill. In the hadith it said that Sayyiduna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to say, "Muru Abu Bakr fal yusalli bin nas," that tell Abu Bakr, command Abu Bakr on behalf of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that he should lead the people in salah. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu led salah where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was still alive with the command of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's an indication that Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu should have been khalif after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Law kuntu muttakhidhan ghayra rabbi khalilan, lattakhastu Abu Bakr khalila." That if I was to make anyone my close friend apart from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will make Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu my khalif. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi my friend. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this hadith, he is saying that if I was to take anyone more close to me than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will take Abu Bakr as-Siddiq as close to me as my close friend. This is also an indication regarding the highest rank of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that he has the close connection with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In another hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, and the background of that hadith is that all the Sahaba at the time who were living in Al-Madinah Al-Munawwara, because they were a small community, so their houses were close to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's masjid, and everybody from their house, they had access to the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Before we proceed further, we think we have a caller on the line. Hello caller, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
Assalamu alaikum brother.
Wa alaikum assalam, yes brother.
Actually I want to ask the Maulana Sahib a question.
Inshallah.
About the prayer, namaz.
Yes, please.
Actually I'm working with the different shifts like, you know, but these days are very short time between Zohar and Asr and Maghrib, as you know that. They are okay. Very close together.
Mm-hmm.
The time on the breaks, mm-hmm. we can't get the three breaks after hour and so.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible we can read Zohar and Asr together and then Maghrib and Isha together?
Okay, Jazakallah khair, mashallah. Jazakallah, very nice question, mashallah. Do you have any other question, brother?
No, this is the one.
Okay, Jazakallah khair, mashallah. Keep listening, brother, inshallah, I'll answer, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair.
Okay.
Mashallah, barakallah. Assalamu alaikum, mashallah. Brother has asked a very nice question that nowadays the days are very short. So as we are in work, we cannot get long breaks. So is it allowed to combine our salah in a way that we don't miss our salah as well? Mashallah, the answer is, brother, that because nowadays very short days, so what you can do, my suggestion is that, for example, you can take your Zuhur Salah until the end of Zuhur Salah time. For example, normally in the winter days, Zuhur Salah time begins around 12 o'clock and Zuhur Salah time ends around 2:10 or 2:15. So what I can suggest for you, that take your Zuhur Salah time just at the end of Zuhur Salah time, which is around 2 o'clock, and pray your Zuhur Salah time, and then just wait for a few moments, and then Asr Salah time will begin, which is around 2:15 nowadays in the month of December, and then pray your Asr Salah. So what you are doing by this is that you are praying your Zuhar and Asr in both time. Because Allah Azza wa Jalla has said in the Holy Quran that inna salata kanat ala al-mu'minina kitaban mawquta, that as far as the salah is concerned, they are made compulsory upon the believers in the prescribed time. So you are praying your Zuhur salah in the Zuhur salah time, and you are praying your Asr salah in the Asr salah time if you are doing in this manner. Similarly, for Maghrib salah, Maghrib normally around 4 o'clock for the month of December. So what you do is that you pray your Maghrib salah in the Maghrib salah time, because Maghrib salah you have to pray straight after sunset. If, for example, if the people don't let you have a break at 4 o'clock, then Maghrib Salah time remains around 5:15 until around 5:20. So from 2 o'clock, if you have prayed your Asr and Zuhar, and then after 3 hours you get another break, inshallah. So if you can't pray Maghrib at 4 o'clock, inshallah, before 5 o'clock if you pray, inshallah, your Maghrib will be, inshallah, performed in the time. So that would be should be okay. But you should try your best to perform Maghrib Salah on the time, which is around 4 o'clock. However, for Isha Salah, you have a whole night, mashallah, my brother. So therefore, there is no need to combine Isha with Maghrib. Isha, you can come back and pray your Isha Salah at home. Or if you are doing work at night shift, you can pray your Isha further up down as well. For example, after 10 o'clock, after 11 o'clock, whenever you have the break, you can pray your Isha Salah. Because alhamdulillah, for Isha Salah in the winter days, we have such a long time. For example, from nearly about 5:30 in the afternoon, in the evenings, all the way until midnight. So such a long period of time. So I think that should be a good, inshallah, way of performing your salah in the workplace, that you are not doing qaza as well, plus you are not doing them out of their time, neither are you doing them before their time. You are doing all the salah in their right due time. So just delay your asr until just before the time runs out, delay your zuhar until the time just runs out, just to the end, and then pray your zuhar. And as soon as zuhar time ends and asr time begins, pray your asr salah. And Maghrib time, try to pray at 4 o'clock. If they don't allow you, then you can pray 4:30. But don't go until Isha times begin, which is around 5:20. So try to pray before that, inshallah. And inshallah, you'll be praying your Maghrib in the time as well. And for Isha, alhamdulillah, you don't have to combine with Maghrib. However, if you want to do it, for example, if you want to do Isha and Maghrib together, so just at the end of Maghrib, just pray your Maghrib Salah. And then as soon as Isha time begins, at that time, pray your Isha Salah. Or because for Isha Salah, we have the long night, you can pray any time between the beginning of Isha until the midnight. So you can pray, inshallah, anytime between that. Jazakumullah khair. My brothers and my sisters, as we are covering that Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, so Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said in the hadith that everyone closed their entrance to the masjid illa khawkhatu Abi Bakr, except for the door of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, because Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he has the highest rank in the ummah. Therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has ordered the gate of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu to remain open. So therefore, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has given all these hints that after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu ta'ala anhu should be the khalif. Even in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as well, Sahaba, it was a custom amongst them. The Sahaba, they used to say, Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wa Abu Bakr wa Umar wa Uthman. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said so. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam done so. And similar was done by Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman as well. So this was the custom as well, that Abu Bakr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was the first person mentioned after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As far as Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu is concerned, after the demise of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Sahaba got together in the area called Saqifa Banu Sa'ida, all the Sahaba, they sat there and they were discussing the matter that who should be appointed as the Khalif. So many of the opinions came. At that time, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu stood up, and Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave a very nice explanation. He said, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about Sahabi Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala عنه, when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam migrated from Makkah al-Mukarramah to al-Madina al-Munawwara, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam took with him Sayyiduna Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the scene in the Holy Quran in Surah At-Tawbah. Allah Azza wa Jalla has said, ثَانِيَ ثَنَيْنِ إِذْهُمَا فِي الْغَارِ إِذْ يَقُولُ لِصَاحِبِهِ لَا تَحْزَنْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَانَا. Sayyiduna Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, who is this Allah ta'ala referring to? Saniyas Nain, that prophet is one of the two. Who is the second person with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Thaniyas Nain. Idhuma fil ghar. Allah ta'ala said, when they both were in the cave with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, huma, dhamir, pronoun is returning to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Idhuma fil ghar. إذ يقول لصاحبه, when Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was saying to his companion, who was with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, إذ يقول لصاحبه لا تحزن, do not be worried. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, don't worry. Who is that person Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talking to? Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ مَعَنَا, verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. By saying ma'ana, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is adding another person with him. Who is that another person? Is Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So in this ayah, around five ways Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu is mentioned with him. So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu asked the Sahaba that amongst the Sahaba, does anyone else have these virtues, that in the Quran so many times Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with him Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu is mentioned? Does any other Sahabi have this virtue? All the Sahaba, they replied that no. Then Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu stretched his hands and he said, I am giving my bay'ah, my allegiance, my obedience to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu as a khalif. And as Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu gave his obedience to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, all the other Sahaba, they followed, and Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu was appointed as the successor, as the Khalif of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Another brother has asked a very nice question that we have discussed about this so many times before as well, but because he has asked, inshallah, we'll discuss it again today, that is it wrong to fold the hands below the navels in Salah? That if I hold my hands in Salah below the navels, is it wrong? Am I doing something wrong? Or is it correct? Is it proven from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? But brothers and my sisters, as far as our Sharia is concerned, in our Sharia there are some major issues and there are some minor issues. As far as the major issues are concerned, there is no dispute amongst the Ummah. All the Ummah unanimously, they are united regarding the Tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, regarding the belief of the hereafter, regarding the belief of the messengers alayhi salatu wa salam, which we normally recite in Iman and Mufassal. We say in Arabic, Amantu billahi wa malaikatihi wa kutubihi wa rusulihi wal yawm al-akhiri wal qadri khayrihi wa sharrihi min Allahi ta'ala. These are the fundamentals of Iman, and they are the seven articles of Iman. We have to have faith in them. So everybody has faith in these. However, with some of the minor actions, we have a bit of differences, and that difference is proven from Quran, is from the flexibility given from the Quran, or from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the differences we see in Salah, when the men pray Salah, that men, some of the men, they place their hands on their chest, and some of the men, they place their hands below their navels. Both of this practice is proven from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and from the practice of the Salaf, and from the practice of the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. Therefore, we cannot neglect one another. We cannot say this one is correct and the other one is not correct. They're both from the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and from the practice of the Sahaba ridwanullahi alayhim ajma'in. As far as placing the hands on the chest is concerned, it's narrated from one Sahabi by the name Sayyiduna Wa'il ibn Hujr radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was from Yemen. He came to Al-Madina Al-Munawwara, and he came in the winter season, and he saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praying his salah, and Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after saying the first takbir, which is known as takbir at-tahrima, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam placed his hand on the chest, and then he wrapped his body with the shroud. Sayyiduna Wail ibn Hujr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu went back to Yemen and he said, I've been to Al-Madina Al-Munawwara and I saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam practicing like that, and he was placing his hand on the chest. Therefore, those scholars who took the opinion, the hadith from Sayyiduna Wail ibn Hujr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, they are with the opinion that in the salah, we should place our hands on the chest, because Sayyiduna Wail ibn Hujr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu has narrated like this. And this hadith is found in Sahih ibn Khuzaymah by Imam ibn Khuzaymah rahmatullahi alayhi. But remember that the hadith is in Sahih ibn Khuzaymah, but hadith by itself is not a Sahih hadith. According to the terms of the Muhaddithun, this hadith is not Sahih, this hadith is Da'if. According to the terms of the Muhaddithun, this hadith is weak, because there is a narrator by the name Mu'ammil ibn Ismail, and because of the narrator, that hadith rank has gone down from the Sahih to Da'if. However, because this hadith is there in the book and it's been considered practiced by the Salaf, therefore if a person practices on that hadith, he is also practicing the Sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is the opinion of Sayyiduna Imam al-Shafi'i rahmatullahi alayhi. Therefore, we see people who follow the Shafi'i madhab, they place their hands on the chest, which is totally fine. There is nothing wrong with that. Second opinion, which is the opinion of Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Sufyan al-Sawri rahmatullahi alayhi, Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullahi alayhi, and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi, that when we pray our salah, we place our hands below the navel. And they take their opinion from the three of the hadith narrated from Sayyiduna Ali ibn Abi Talib radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, from Sayyiduna Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, and from Sayyiduna Abu Huraira radiallahu ta'ala anhu. All these three hadiths, they are found in Sunan Abi Dawud of Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi. Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi, actually when we study the six books of the hadith, all the six books of hadith, they are actually quiet regarding where a person should place their hands. Okay, they always talk about how to begin the salah with takbirat ahrima. All the six books of hadith, they have the hadith in there. However, where to place the hands, there is nothing in Sahih Bukhari, there is nothing in Sahih Muslim, there is nothing in Jami' al-Tirmidhi, there is nothing in Sunan al-Nasa'i, there is nothing in Sunan Ibn Majah. Only the book of hadith, from the six books of hadith which contains hadith regarding where to place hands in salah, it's only Sunan of Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi. So Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi, in the copy which is printed for a Maktaba Dar es Salaam in Riyadh in Saudi Arabia, in that print Imam Abu Dawud rahmatullahi alayhi has narrated six hadith. Out of these six hadith, three of the hadith, they talk about placing the hands below the navel, which is proven from Sayyiduna Ali radiyallahu anhu, Sayyiduna Abu Huraira radiyallahu anhu, and Sayyiduna Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. One of the hadith, which is a hadith mursal, a tabi'i narrates from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by the name Taus ibn Kaysan rahmatullahi alayhi. He says Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would place the hands on the chest. And the remaining two hadiths, they are quiet. They just talk about placing the hands, but and folding the hands in salah, but where to place the hands and where to leave them, they are silent about it. Therefore, these three hadiths, he says, place the hands below the navel, from Sayyiduna Ali radiallahu anhu, Sayyiduna Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, and Sayyiduna Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Therefore, a huge majority of the ummah, such as Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, Imam Sufyan al-Sawri, and Imam Abdullah ibn Mubarak, their opinion is that we place the hands below the navel, and they took that these ahadith into the consideration. Therefore, if a person prays a salah by folding the hands below the navel, these are also from the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is why Sayyiduna Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi, he has said in Jami' al-Tirmidhi that if a person places the hands on the chest, he's also allowed to do so. And if a person placed the hands below the navel, he's also allowed to do so. And Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi gave a very nice conclusion that this is nothing to fight about or argue about. Both of these practices are proven from the practice of the Salaf and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, whoever has took any of the opinion, he is doing the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Therefore, if a person practices the hadith narrated by Wail ibn Hujr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he's also practicing the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he's placing the hands on the chest. And if a person takes the hadith of Sayyiduna Ali, Sayyiduna Abu Huraira, and Sayyiduna Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala anhum, and he places the hands below the navel, he is also taking the sunnah into consideration, and he's practicing the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I should mention one thing as well before we proceed, and that is that both of the hadith, either the hadith of Wail ibn Hajar in Ibn Khuzaymah, or hadith of Sayyiduna Ali or Anas ibn Malik Malik or Abu Huraira found in Abu Dawood, both of the hadith technically in the terms of the muhaddithun, they are known as da'if. They are known as da'if, they are known as weak. Therefore, there is no chance of arguing that which one is the strongest, either this one is sahih or that one is sahih. They're both in the same level, they're both in the terms of the muhaddithun, they are da'if, and we have just translated the word da'if as weak. This is the translation of it. However, the terminology is used as da'if, which is not sahih. Therefore, both of these hadiths in the ranking, they come in the category of da'if. Therefore, both of them, they're in the same category. Whatever way a person practices, they both are in the same category and they are allowed to do so. My brothers and my sisters, we are coming right to the end of the program, Islam in Life. We discuss about the beauty, physical beauty of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As far as the physical beauty of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is concerned, a person may write books after books. A person may deliver lectures after lectures. A person may do anything, but he cannot come to the conclusion from that. Therefore, we cannot finish the beauty of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Inshallah, we'll continue with the same topic, inshallah, next week as well. Please be with us. Jazakallah for viewing. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.